Hey everybody, you're in for a treat. We're going to be doing a video on the topic of why I left atheism for Christianity, for the awesome person of Jesus Christ. And what better way to do it, guys, than on this motorcycle on this beautiful day here in California. We're going to be taking this bike because it's a lot of fun to take through the twisties. You know, I own a 600 motorcycle. This is just a 250, but more people like to see this bike going through the twisties because it's a lot of fun to ride. So we're going to be taking this, the Kawasaki Ninja 250. By the way, my atheist friends and subscribers, this is a product of intelligent design. It didn't just pop into existence like how atheists think the universe did. Even though the universe also is a product of intelligent design. So let's do this, guys. We're going to put the camera in the fastener here so it's hands-free. Let's see. We are set. You guys ready? So let's just get right to riding and talking. I've done some other videos like this when I go through the reasons why I left the madness of atheism for Christianity. But there's so many reasons. So I can do so many videos on the same topic. So here's what we're going to do. Just before we get started, this is the fuel gauge. This is the speedometer. This is the tachometer. We're starting it up. And check this out, which is really cool. Let me just get off real quick. They put this pipe on it. So this little 250, look, it actually has like a growl to it, which is really cool. Just awesome. So let's get going. And let's start off with a question. I want my atheist friends to answer this question. Is absence of evidence evidence of absence? Let's start off with that topic. Is absence of evidence evidence of absence? Do you believe absence of evidence is evidence of absence? Please answer that. And let me zip up my pockets, make sure I don't lose any keys or anything like that. Bear with me. Here we go. Okay, I want to show you something. This is the gear shift lever. You shift it upward to shift upward. You kick down to shift downward. This is the clutch lever. This is the front brake. That, my friends, is the rear brake. So is absence of evidence evidence of absence? Clutch in, kick down, we're in first. Let's go. In other words, look at that house up there. I have no evidence someone's in that house. I have no evidence if anyone's even in there. Does that mean no one's in that house? Of course not. Someone could actually be in that house. So we're going to start off this video with, and let's get some good speed so I know what you guys like. Hold on, my other jacket zipper. There we go. So I'll try to do this at a good clip of speed so make it exciting for you. We're going down a steep hill right now. So you're going to kind of see it in the camera. One of the reasons why people become atheists is they don't think properly. That's why I started off with that question. Is absence of evidence actually evidence for absence? In other words, I had no evidence back there that someone was in that house or not. Does that then mean that nobody is in the house? Of course not. What about that house up there? I have no evidence someone's in that house. So would we logically say, therefore, no one's in the house? Of course not. This is a big mistake atheists make. They think that absence of evidence, because I haven't yet shown that someone's in that house up there, that therefore that means no one's in the house. That's the evidence, that's the error of atheism. For example, there's some horses right there. I have no evidence that the horses have been ridden yet. They could be wild, untamed horses. I have no evidence of that, but does that mean that the horse is a wild, untamed horse? No, it could actually be a tame horse. So we're going to talk about some of the ways atheists think, and if they didn't think that way, they wouldn't be atheists, because they're not thinking logically. You know, it's tough for atheists, because if they're an evidentialist, and what that means is they don't, and most atheists are evidentialists. The problem with that is there's no evidence that atheism is even true or accurate or correct. So if an atheist will only believe things which have evidence, then they can't be atheists, because they have no evidence that atheism is even true. At the top of this video, please guys, you've got to see this, you're going to die laughing. There's a website where they do debates, debatesonvideo.blogspot.com. You see it here? Go there and watch Cliff, he's a Christian, defeat Matt Dillahunty from the Atheist Experience Show. He defeats Matt, and he defeats him on this question. He asks Matt, okay, you believe atheism is true. What evidence have you seen that would show you that atheism is true? Why are you living your life as an atheist? What evidence have you seen that would show that you're living your life the correct way, choosing the atheist lifestyle? And Matt couldn't provide any. It was just his opinion, and he lost that debate. You've got to go see that. One of the big problems with atheism is they have no proof and evidence that atheism is accurate and correct. And I got to be careful up here, because there's wild donkeys that run across this road. However, if I do hit the donkey and I go head over heels, that would make for a great YouTube video. So either way, we win, guys. By the way, if I die crashing into the donkey, whoever gets this video, please upload it to YouTube. It'll make for a great YouTube video. Okay. Speaking of asses, donkeys, asses, let's talk about atheism. So this is a mistake that atheists make. If they're going to be an evidentialist, then you must provide proof and evidence that atheism is true. But the fact of the matter is there is no evidence that atheism is true. Now, I know what you guys are going to say, because what atheists do is they shrink from the argument. As soon as you ask them, what proof and evidence do you have that atheism is true, they're going to say, well, no, atheism isn't a claim. They're going to shrink from it, because we all know atheists claim God doesn't exist. When we ask them for proof and evidence that would show that this is a fact, they don't have any. Sometimes atheists will say you can't prove a negative, you can't prove something has never happened or something doesn't exist. I can prove, as of this day, August 2016, there's never been a woman president. I just proved it. I proved a negative. We've never had, nor has there ever existed, a woman president up to August 2016. I'm saying this because Hillary is running against Trump right now, and if Hillary wins, then we would have a woman president. If Trump wins, we wouldn't. So this is what atheists will say. They'll say, no, we don't have to provide proof and evidence, because atheism is true, because we're just claiming we don't believe God exists. Well, then you're just stating an opinion. You're stating an opinion that has no truth value to it. It's like if you were saying you feel like you're warm. Heck, it could be, look at the heck. Let's go back and talk to that donkey. Let's see if that donkey has more knowledge than atheists. So we just saw a little donkey out here. We're going to go tell the donkey to skedaddle before it gets squished. Oh no, he's going across the street. Look at him. Yeah, don't bother us, donkey. Oh, okay. All right. I do not... Man, those donkeys got some long ears. I do not want to... There they go. I do not want to hit the donkeys. Let's turn around. Well, this is good. Run, donkeys, run your little legs. So we got to be careful going through here because there's some live donkeys. Look at, what the heck are you lost? Another donkey over there. Look at him in the mirror. Okay, so atheists will say, and this is the problem, this is another reason why I left atheism, it doesn't make sense logically, and I want to be a logical, rational person, but you can't be if you're atheist. First of all, answer the question, does absence of evidence mean that there's evidence that something doesn't exist, that there's evidence of absence? We already showed you that absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. There could actually be someone in that house over there. Now, I don't know if any more donkeys are going to be running across the street. I don't have any evidence of that. Does that then mean that no donkeys are going to run across the street? Of course not. The donkeys could actually still be running across the street. So, let's pick up some speed here. This is a blast. Sorry, having fun while I'm making this video. So, check it out. It says we're going about 50 now. Around this corner. I don't know why it said 45 on it. So atheists will then say, no, we just don't believe in God. Well, that's not enough to prove atheism is true. For example, the Muslim doesn't believe atheism, you don't believe Islam if you're an atheist. Does that then mean both sides are true? Of course not. You have a contradiction. Everyone here agrees. 100% of all the viewers of this video agree that either God exists or he doesn't exist. So I'm going to talk to you about why I left the madness of atheism. And believe it or not, I left because of the same problem of why I left atheism. I left atheism because the lack of evidence. I really did. There is no, oh, now you show me the donkey sign. You see the warning of the donkey sign back there? They need to put that sign back the other way. So I left atheism because there is no evidence that atheism is accurate or correct. Do you know that I've challenged Aaron Raw on YouTube to provide some type of proof and evidence that would show atheism is true, and he couldn't do it? I challenged the number one most subscribed to atheist on YouTube, the amazingly hellbound atheist, the amazing atheist, amazingly hellbound, and he couldn't do it. Let me downshift. In matter of fact, type this in a YouTube search, and you'll see the amazing atheist on video, the amazingly hellbound atheist, admitting that he cannot prove that atheism is accurate and correct. It's basically a faith-based statement that he's giving when he's saying atheism is true. It's just based on faith, blind faith that he had. Type in proof atheism is madness, and you'll see the number one most subscribed to atheist on YouTube admit that he cannot, quoting him, he cannot prove that atheism is accurate and correct. Well, we sure risk a lot. Wow, a bunch of motorcycles coming over. Nice. We sure risk a lot through atheism being atheist. If atheism isn't true, then that means God exists, doesn't it? And the amazing atheist admits he can't prove that atheism is true. And if you're an evidentialist, see where I'm going with this? The atheist is actually saying God exists with his own argument. If the atheists say they're not going to believe in anything unless it has evidence, and the number one most subscribed to atheist on YouTube, including also Richard Dawkins, Lawrence Krauss, all these atheists, they've all admitted that there is no evidence that atheism is true. Well, logically speaking, then atheism cannot be true. There you go. Thank you. We brought you to the light. Now, was Jesus a historical person? Yes. Okay, that's a good reason to believe Christianity is true. Did people say Jesus rose from the dead? Yes, that's a good reason to believe Christianity is true. Has Christianity changed lives for the better? Yes, that's a good reason to believe Christianity is true. Yeah, but have any prophecies been made in the Bible? Yes, they've all come true. That's another good reason to believe Christianity is true. Seems like the weight of the evidence is going on the side of Christianity. We have atheism, and all the atheists admit, by the way, I'm going to get you guys some fast, fun freeway riding real quick. You know what? I was doing this, and I just hit this bump, and we got airborne. That was amazing. Good thing I had this other hand on the throttle holding on to it. Okay, let's get you some fun freeway riding. And then we're going to take it to some more twisties if I have battery time. So we have atheists admitting that there is no proof and evidence that atheism is true. We've challenged Matt Dillahunty. I've reached out to the atheist community just to show them the error of their ways. We've challenged them to provide proof and evidence that atheism is accurate and correct. Matt Dillahunty and the entire Atheist Experience Show cast failed. Look for Proof Atheism is Madness on YouTube, and you'll see that they failed to answer that question. They couldn't do it. Bear with me, got a little blind corner here. Okay, let's talk about some other things that should really concern atheists. With the discovery of DNA, they have found that DNA is a language. I'm going to give you another video. Check out Stephen Meyer. He's an author of a book called Signature in the Cell, where he shows that DNA could not come about by purely natural processes. DNA is actual information. It's like it's a language. And scientifically, we know only one thing that produces language, and that is intelligence. You have to have some type of intelligence, some intelligent design to produce language. And there's the freeway up there. You know, Stephen Meyer, and this is one of the reasons why I left atheism too, is because of DNA. I can't turn a blind eye to it and just say, I know it looks designed, I know that it's a language, I know all these things, but I'm going to go against what the evidence says, and I'm going to say that it was just luck and chance and randomness. I can't be a fool and be an atheist. I just can't do it. So look up Signature in the Cell, Stephen Meyer, and let me give you an analogy that he uses. He shows, you know, those magnetic boards that you can put on your refrigerator, and the board is magnet, but the letters are also magnet, and then you can put the letters on the board and spell out things, and you have this attraction between the other magnet and then the letters that are magnetized. Well, check this out, guys. He goes to show that there's no possible way this can all be done just by luck. There has to be some type of intelligence involved that put this information there. Just like if you're spelling letters out on one of those magnetic refrigerator boards, it takes intelligence to spell out the letters. There's no magic between the letter and the magnet. There's nothing to that. What they're amazed at is there's actually intelligence involved, intelligent design. Something of intelligence had to place this information, just like how we're placing the information on the magnetic board on the refrigerator. Something had to place that in the right sequence. That video, Stephen Meyer's Signature in the Cell, is awesome. But let's go through some other things. You know, when I was an atheist, I did find it suspicious that atheists always bash God. And I would talk to them, well, why are you, bashing God if he doesn't exist? And they would say, this is their answer to me, well, look at all the people that God killed in the flood. And these are atheists that are trying to say that God doesn't exist. So I come to realize that atheists really do know that God exists. they just don't like God. They want to live a deviant lifestyle or whatnot. You ever notice most atheists are homosexuals if they stay in atheism long enough? You ever notice that? There's been studies that link that the longer you're with, in atheism, the higher your chances are of you becoming a gay. I'm going to give you a radio study. Go below this video and you're going to notice it says blogtalkradio.com. Go there and listen to the radio show where, hold on, we're getting on the freeway. This is awesome. Anyways, go to blogtalkradio.com below this video. You'll see my radio show and listen to our opinion and our studies on how atheism increases your chance to be light in the loafers. It's a proven fact. You gotta escape it while you can. Here we go. Extremely hot day in Southern California. So, my atheist friends would say, well, God killed all these people in the flood. And they were, another thing too, speaking of atheism, there is a link between atheism and homosexuality. And now atheists even want to have sex with animals. I'm going to show you. Look below this video and you'll see some links. Click those links and you can see some studies where atheists said that there's nothing wrong. Like, let's say an atheist sees a goat that they got their eye on, or that donkey back there. Let's say the goat sees a donkey that it happens to like. Well, on atheism, atheists are now saying, since they believe they're just evolved animals, let's get on it as much as I can on this 250 here. Since atheists are just evolved animals, that's what atheists are saying. They're saying, let's get on it. So, and there are atheists saying, yeah, there's nothing wrong with atheist human doing it with an animal, because after all, they're both just animals. And in their opinion, sin doesn't exist. I'm not making this up. This is how far atheism has gone into the mire. Click below this video and look at the links. The atheists are actually saying that now. Can you imagine if an atheist is walking down the street and they see a sheep? That's just... And the atheist starts thinking these thoughts. I want you to imagine the atheist is walking down the street and he sees a sheep, and then all of a sudden you hear this music start. Just you and me. Dun, dun, dun. My first, my last, my everything. You're the answer to all my dreams. So you hear, you start hearing this romantic music playing as the atheist sees the sheep. I don't think that's good. I think it's bad. In fact, I think it's bad, bad. I don't think the sheep wants to get intimate with the atheist. But this is what the atheists are. What's that singer, Barry, who sings my first? Barry White, yes. So Barry White, I believe that's the singer. Barry White starts singing my first, my last, my everything. No, it's just not good, folks. So, let's just slow this down. So I started thinking, you got the problem with atheists and the animals. That's the next thing in evolution that they're saying they want to do, which I think is just bad. Dun, dun, dun. You really got to go and do it. Dun, dun, dun. Just you and me. Dun, dun, dun. Oh, atheism offers us so much opportunity for comedy. Seriously. Okay. So we're going to get off here. Because I missed the off-ramp, I was laughing so hard at the atheist sheep analogy. Oh, that was so funny. So that's one thing I've noticed is the atheists also, oh, that's what I wanted to tell you. This is good. I just thought of that. The atheists also, they don't like when God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. They'll talk about that all the time. God doesn't like the gays. Let me tell you God's opinion on the gays. Seriously. God doesn't look at it as the gays and normal people. He doesn't look at it like that. He looks at it as everyone's equal. Everyone's equal, okay? I hope there's an on-ramp here because I got to get back and go that way. Or I could take this road. Oh, there is an on-ramp. Okay. He looks at it as everyone's equal, and there are certain sins that we shouldn't do. You know, when in the Bible, there's a story about Abraham, and God has this conversation. He says, should I tell Abraham what I'm going to do to Sodom and Gomorrah? Because God was going to destroy it. Should I keep this from Abraham? But God tells Abraham and Lot, look, this city, it was like Hollywood. This city has got so wicked, I'm going to destroy it. Go read this in Genesis. So God sends these three men that are actually angels, but they're in the form of men. He sends them to Sodom and Gomorrah. And Lot is an upright man. You know, he's a good guy, but he's living in the pit of hell right there in Sodom and Gomorrah. And Lot sees these three men come in, and he wants to protect them. He wants to get them out of there as soon as possible. So he tells them, he begs them, he says, look, sojourn with me in my house. Come in my house. Stay all night. He doesn't even want them to go out into the square, because then these angels will see the rampant, blatant homosexuality in the streets. And so he says, stay with me all night. All you three men, just stay here in my house. I'll feed you. I'll take care of you and everything. But then in the morning, early, he wants them to go early so they don't see any of the sin of the city. In the morning, you can get up and leave. And here we go, folks, the twisties. You're going to love this. But the angels say, nay, we're not going to do that. We're going to stay right here in the square. Lot is terrified that the angels are going to see this. And the angels are there to scope out the place and plan the judgment of this area, right? They're going to destroy it. But Lot persists and he begs the angels, please, you know, so the angels say, okay, we will. But the militant homosexuals, I know this isn't politically correct, but you know what modern day Christians say to political correctness? Political correctness can go to hell. As a Christian, we don't change our opinion based on the way society changes. We stick with the Word of God, don't we, guys? So I'm not going to bow down at the altar of political correctness and filter my words through this altar because I'm scared of what the militant atheist or militant homosexual, same thing, what they're going to do. We got to preach the word. So here's what happened. The militant homosexual. I said it. That's right. The militant gays. They surround the house where the angels are at. And how do I say this without offending anybody? These militant angels. I'm sorry, the militant. The angels were. That guy putting his brakes on threw me off. I thought I was going to go over the foot of it. The militant gays. They actually tell Lot, hey, get those guys out here. They wanted to rape the angels. And after all, under atheism,
there is no sin, there's no evil. We already know what they're trying to do with the animals. Look at the links below, you can go see. So the Lot says, look, I got some daughters here. They've never been with a man. You know, you could take them. Back then, women basically had no rights in that culture. Well, limited rights. But the angels protect the women, and the angels protect Lot, and they grab Lot and pull him back in because the militant gays, that's right, I said it. The militant gays were busting down the door trying to rape the angels. And the angels said, look, you got to get out of here. Run for your very life because we're going to destroy this place. And Lot's trying to run. He's trying to make it there. They say, go to these mountains over here. And Lot prays. He's like, please, you know, can I go to this other city? Because I don't think I'm going to make it there in time. I'll die. So the angels say, run for your life. Get to this other town because we can't destroy this one till you're gone. And God, in his political incorrect ways, fire and brimstone comes down from heaven and destroys Sodom and Gomorrah. Ah, the good old days. See, atheists don't like what I'm saying. They don't like it. They want God to have tolerance for evil. You know, what is the problem with God? Why can't he just tolerate evil and put up with it? And this leads me to why Jesus came. God cannot tolerate sin, folks. He don't want to tolerate it. Thank God, because I'm a sinner. Cocos frios. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. I admit it, but the atheists don't admit it. If you've gotten angry with your brother before, and oh boy, I've been angry, people pulling out in front of me, that's a sin. But at least I admit it. Atheists don't think it's a sin. So God is so holy and just, he must judge sin. Richard Dawkins says, well, why does he have to send his son to die? Why can't he just forgive? And you know what? I've seen a few sheep that I thought looked pretty cute. No, Richard, it's just bad. So Richard Dawkins says, why can't God just forgive? Like, verbally. John Lennox said it best. John Lennox defeated Richard Dawkins in debate. Go to debatesonvideo.blogspot.com to see John Lennox defeating the limp-wristed, very feminine Richard Dawkins. But Richard Dawkins said, Richard Dawkins said, oh, thanks, brother. He said, he didn't say thanks, brother. That guy in the van was telling me to go for it. Why can't God just forgive? And John Lennox said, because God is just, God must judge sin. And what I look at God as an artist. I look at God as brilliant. He creates the universe for the entire fact of glorifying himself. He creates the bright sun in the sky to glorify himself. He created the stars, the moon, to glorify himself. And he created us to glorify God. So sin must be judged. And I'm going to say some other politically incorrect words. The Bible says that the wrath of God abides on the sinful man. But thank God that God loved us so much that he said, you know what I'm going to do to get closer to you? And this is the part, as an atheist, it took me time to wrap my brain around this. But as I started reading scripture and educating myself on the awesome person of Jesus Christ, I got it. It all made sense. If you approach it from what is the best thing that God can do for his glory, then it all makes sense. If you approach it from your needs, my needs, then it wouldn't make sense. But remember, God's goal is to glorify himself. I am that I am. So God plants himself in the tenthly flesh of man in this person called Jesus Christ. And he says, I'm going to come and live in a human body. I'm going to experience the pain. I'm going to experience all these temptations coming against people. Now, Jesus was never tempted. They tried to tempt him. Satan tried to tempt him. But Jesus never had this inner temptation because he cannot sin. Jesus is the only person to ever sin. So Jesus comes, he lives a perfect, flawless life. No sin in his life. And then they're so happy Jesus came, they want to make him king. They believe he's the Messiah. He's going to overthrow government. And Jesus says, no, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to die. I'm going to go to the cross. I'm going to die. Peter rebukes him and says, Lord, this will never happen. And Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. You're not doing the will of God. Jesus' plan was he comes, he dies for us. He takes all of your sin. I mean, it's really good news when you think about it. When I finally got it, it made sense. It was so genius, the plan of Christianity. It was so genius. This is why atheists don't get it. If they would sink their nose into the Bible and read it, instead of the fictional book, The God Delusion by Richard Dodo Dawkins, they would get it. Jesus rises from the dead. He connects us with eternity. All of our sins are forgiven because he took our punishment. So God actually pours out his wrath on Jesus Christ. He pours it out, and Jesus takes our sins. I'm thinking right now, there's a militant homosexual guy that is like a transgender or something. I don't know, Zena Jones on YouTube. And Zena Jones made this statement. He said, well, he said, if you look up this video, the meaningless death of Jesus Christ. Hold on, I'm allowed legally to go on the left side. If you look up the video, the meaningless death of Jesus Christ, you'll see Zena Jones saying, well, big deal. So God came down and died. He knew he was going to rise again. And Zena Jones says that Jesus' death is meaningless because he knew he was going to die. Well, I'm glad that Zena admits that Jesus died and rose. We got to give him credit for that. Thanks, brother. But the only thing is, it wasn't meaningless. It was the most meaningful act that ever occurred in history. Because Jesus actually took the pain of the scourge of the whip. He took the pain. He felt the pain, guys. The pain that you and I would have had for eternity in hell. He goes to the cross. You know, in a lot of movies, they show the nails going here. The nails actually didn't go here, the spikes, because it would just rip through your hand. It would go in a very painful place right here below the wrist. Very painful. Touch your finger right now as you're watching this video to your wrist. You can feel how sensitive it is. That's where the spikes went through. So I understood it. I said, you know what? My life as an atheist is finished. It is finished. It's complete. I'm not going to be an atheist anymore. I get it. I get Christianity. It takes intelligence. It takes wisdom. You have to have somewhat intelligence to understand Christianity. You have to have wisdom. You have to understand what God's goal in all this. What is God's goal? What is the purpose? To glorify God. It all makes sense. It is finished. I'm telling you, my atheist subscribers, seriously, you're going to feel like a fool. I feel like a fool for ever being an atheist in my life. There's only one thing more foolish. It's continue being an atheist in your life. So I do hope and pray that the day comes for you like it came for me, where you realize when Jesus said on the cross, it is finished. It is finished. He reached his goal. He died for your sins. He came, he saw, he died, he rose, he was triumphant. You guys need to say what Jesus said about atheism. If you're an atheist, you need to say, it is finished. Now, one way you can do this, go to debatesonvideo.blogspot.com, and here's what I want you to do. Get a piece of paper, draw a line right down the middle of the paper, and every time an atheist in the debate says some proof and evidence, that gives proof and evidence for atheism, you're going to write it down on the left side of the paper. And every time the Christian gives proof and evidence for Christianity, you're going to write it down the right side of the paper. And then I want you to see which side has more weight on it. What I found is, it reminds me of a Bible passage where God goes to this king, because the king is totally rebelling against God, and God says, I weighed you in the balances, and I have found you wanting. In other words, the side of atheism would be up real high in those weights, you know, those scales. The side of atheism would be up real high because there's no weight to it. There's no proof or evidence. The proof and evidence is on the side of Christianity. It is awesome. I remember when I was reading scripture and I was just about to become a Christian, you know, as the Holy Spirit was drawing me closer and closer. And I remember the part where I really got, and I don't cry a lot, but I got choked up and I started crying just as the Holy Spirit just swept over me. And I read the part where Jesus is sitting with his disciples and he says, you know what, I've longed to have this meal with you. And he says he's not going to have that meal with them again and drink of the fruit of the vine until he comes again in glory. And he says to the disciples, and it really hit me like a ton of bricks. It got me pretty emotional, to be honest with you. He said, you know, before now I called you my friends. I'm sorry. He said, before now, I apologize, guys. I messed up. But he said, before now, that's the part that got me choked up. But the part that he says first is, you know, until now I have called you my disciples. But now I call you my friends. And he knows he's going to the cross. This is why he's saying this. See, it all hit me like a ton of bricks, what God was doing. He says, I call you my friends. Before now, I called you disciples, but now I call you my friends because there is no greater gift than to lay down one's life for one's friend. So it's awesome. Jesus comes, he says, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to die. I'm going to go to the cross. I'm going to take your punishment. I'm going to take the pain. You know how Bill Clinton said, I feel your pain. I feel your pain. And he really didn't. Well, Jesus Christ really felt our pain. And then he says, Jesus says, and then I'm going to rise again. And you're going to rise again. It is awesome. It all makes sense. It is finished. So, let's end this video, guys, because I'm going to get a drink here. I'm going to get probably a Monster Energy drink. Sometimes when you're looking at the world and you see the world, it looks like it's going to hell in a handbasket. No, lift your head high. Our redemption draweth nigh. Everything is going as planned. Everything is in God's divine providence. I'm so hopeful for the future.